All right, let's get started with this online lecture for our Capstone Design 1. Just a few very brief announcements before we get into the topic. Don't forget, you still have your first draft of your resume due on October 25th, and your homework one, your ethics writing assignment, is going to be due on Wednesday, October the 11th. When you submit that, you're going to submit it via Blackboard, uploading to MU Online, so you don't need to print that off and bring it to class. Just have it submitted before the beginning of class on October the 11th. Speaking of, I did have a student ask a question sometime earlier in the week about guidelines for the actual paper. I sent those via email. They're pretty basic, just on font and line spacing and whatnot, but make sure you follow those as you write the paper. So today, this should be a somewhat brief video, but we're going to talk about just corporate environments and some professional concepts, financial operations within a company, project documentation, and what have you, because these are going to be some good things that you want to know when you get into the workplace, be it a consultant's office or a government agency or a contractor, anywhere in between. These are going to be some good concepts to learn as you get into the workforce. So let me pull this up. There we go. Okay, so I want to start off just by looking at some general tips for success when you get out of here with your degree and get into the workplace. And I think a lot of these are going to be true regardless of what job you take. Even if it's outside the engineering field, these are just general tips for success. You know, first off, never miss a deadline and always be available. One of the things you will find with careers is that they can tend to go one of two ways. You'll either get promoted and move up the ladder, or you'll remain stagnant. And that's something you definitely want to avoid. And one of the ways that you move up the ladder and demonstrate your worth to either the company that you're working for, or maybe you're getting a job at another company and you're essentially getting promoted. But one of the ways you demonstrate that worth is to be dependable. So always be on time, never miss a deadline. It can only do you favors in the long run. Not only being dependable, but and producing on time, but do your best work. Even if you're doing rebar takeoffs or land surveys or just data collection, do it as well as you can. And this lends to a philosophy. I mean, your manager or your boss is going to take the position. Well, if you're not doing this job well, if you can't sweep the floor well or do a rebar takeoff well or something like that, if you can't do that job, how am I going to trust you to do anything that's more important? So make sure you're dependable. Make sure that you are doing the task as good as possible. I mean, this is a philosophy that even worked out for me. My first job at an engineering firm, I mean, I was doing surveying and doing CAD drawings and things like that. And then over time, next thing you know, I'm being asked to do more and more things for the company because I demonstrated my worth and demonstrated hard work. And that's how you get more and more responsibility, and more responsibility is going to equal more and more salary, more and more cash for you. So it's just something you need to keep in mind. Communication. This is going to be a topic throughout the lecture, but just make sure you're communicating well. It's an incredibly important piece of work, so make sure you're aware of that, and making sure you're going above and beyond the call of duty. I mean, if you're given a task, do that task, and if there's something else that can go along with it, do that as well. It will only serve to benefit you. Yeah, is it more work? Yeah, it's a little more work, but in the end, if it's going to benefit you and the company, it's something you need to be moving on. Now, let's talk about some other specifics regarding professional life, so in regards to positions and promotions. And this is definitely something that young engineering students need to realize when they're seniors. First off, everyone has to serve their time in the trenches. I know when you get out, the first thing you want to do is be a bridge engineer working on multi-million dollar projects and being in charge of all that stuff, it sounds great. But everyone has to serve their time doing basic analysis models, and rebar takeoffs, and things like that. So just recognize that. And what we're getting, what I'm getting at is, you know, if you're getting ready to graduate and you've got a position on the table and it's maybe not your dream position, maybe it's not exactly what you want, but I would accept it. Accept the position while you're there, and even there at the beginning, maybe communicate, hey, I want to do more. I want to contribute more to the company, but accept the position. You know, on day one, you want to have that work experience started. Again, work hard, be dependable. Next thing you know, the next position that you're offered might be one that's a little more suited to your liking. You know, if you refuse a position, that might be it. So that's all, honestly, that's a general task. Honestly, probably should have been on the previous slide, is that if you're given a task to do, don't refuse to do it. If you refuse, again, that might be the last time you ever get offered a position. One thing to also keep in mind is, on day one, when you're a young junior engineer, you know, you're not going to get maybe some of the perks that some of the senior folks at your company or organization will. I mean, senior folks, they'll get more latitude or leniency from management because they have served their time, so they get to reap the benefits. So, you know, like I said, everyone serves their time in the trenches, because 10, 20, 30 years from now, when you're the senior position, you get to experience that latitude that you didn't when you were a junior engineer. So it's just something to think about. Whether you're at company, government organization, what have you, make sure that you understand the management structure of the company above you all the way to the top. It's a good idea to know who's the boss, who's your boss's boss, and so on and so forth. Know names, know the positions, understand the structure of the company. A good rule of thumb is, you know, to look up two levels in management. You know, keep your supervisor happy and your supervisor's supervisor happy. Because in the end, that's just going to pay off in the end. But one real important aspect of that is, make sure that you're respecting the chain of command. You know, don't go over your boss's head. It's okay to ask questions, in regards to moving things forward in the company. But if you get a decision that you don't like from your boss, and you're going to your boss's boss and complaining about it, that's not going to go very well for you. So make sure that you're respecting the chain of command. Again, that will benefit you in the long run. Sorry about that. All right, meetings, okay. Being a professional, being an engineer, in this world, you are going to go to a lot of meetings. It's just fact of professional life. So if you are responsible for organizing meetings, which is, you know, very possible, even at a beginning young age, you know, junior engineering status and what have you, if you're responsible for a meeting, first thing, you know, send the agenda out early so people can prepare and see who else is going to be there. It's actually something that these are pieces of advice that I try and follow and adhere to quite strictly when I organize meetings. If it's not a meeting, maybe it's a conference call, but make sure you keep people well aware of that. It's also usually a good idea to set some sort of time limit for each agenda item and try and stick to it. I mean, if you're calling a meeting or calling a conference call or something like that, you're doing it for a reason. So if you've got five or six topics that you need to talk through within a given meeting or a given conference call or something like that, you need to go through it. So try and keep everybody on task. Try and keep yourself on task and stick to your agenda, because, again, it's going to move business along much further and much more efficiently. Now, as a follow-up to that, one thing that is going to be very important in regards to your success and your company's success when you're working on projects is taking accurate notes and keeping up with your correspondence. When you're working on a project, you've got the details and you've got the dimensions and the figures and the data square in your head. 10, 12 projects down the line, you're not going to remember it. So you are going to want to take notes on top of notes. You document every decision that you've made on a given project, every explanation for why you've made that decision. Document your references. Document the codes and specifications that you're following. If you're getting data from a manufacturer, document where you got that, websites, emails, whole nine yards. Make sure you do everything. When I was working at my engineering firm, each job essentially had a quote-unquote a job folder, and every single piece and scrap of paper went into that job folder, whether it was, just notes that were jotted down about a given job, calculations, data points, plats, drawings, you name it. Everything went into that folder, because 2 years down the line, 3 years down the line, if you have to refer to something that you did in that job, well, that's what you're going to be referring to. So put every single thing that you can together. Make sure you're well organized with it. And again, make sure you're very clear. It's also, if you've got you've had a conference call or something like that, or you've had a discussion, it's always a good idea to follow that discussion up. If there are key decisions that were made, follow that up with some sort of email or letter or something like that. If you've got a meeting that's been taking place, usually minutes or something like that are taken during the meeting. So just again, accurate note keeping is incredibly important. Okay. Let's talk about money a little bit. After all, the main goal, if it's a consulting firm or a construction company, is to make money. And even if you don't work for a consulting firm or a construction company, if you work for a government agency, you need to understand that. Okay. So that means tracking money, profits, billable hours, balance sheets, things like that. At the very beginning of any financial tracking, at least from your end, as a junior engineer, all of this financial tracking starts with a timesheet. Okay, now a timesheet is a legal document, so you need to treat it as one. The timesheet serves as a basis for how clients are billed. And if there are issues with billing and finances on a given project, and projects get litigated upon, this is what's going to be called into information. So it's a legal document. Treat it as one. No one should submit a timesheet for another. No one should modify another's timesheet after it's submitted. Okay. Make sure you're submitting your timesheets when they are due. Accounting problems, if late, will occur if they're late. You'll have legal problems with payroll. This is a big deal. So make sure you're keeping track of your timesheets. Now, timesheets don't need to be significantly complicated. They're fairly straightforward. This is just an example timesheet. This is more on what you would kind of see if you're looking at. This is sort of like an academic timesheet, but really it's pretty straightforward. What you might find in a job setting. So for instance, we've got a weekly timesheet for a given individual, and you see the tasks that are performed. Sometimes, usually what you'll find in addition to this is not just tasks, but job numbers or in relation to a given project. This was the task on this given project, because ultimately, for instance, if your firm, most firms will attach a project number or a job number to a given client. So essentially what you're doing is, if this is job, 123A, you think all you have to do is query all of the line items from 123A, and that forms what you bill the client. So that's usually what you'll see on top of that. But you'll see things like, for instance, this is an academic example, so attended lecture prep, meet on MSE wall design, what have you. But this is pretty straightforward stuff. So one thing you'll also see is usually the way that timesheets are tabulated, you'll see here, for instance, each task is summed and then each day is summed. So on the bottom, you see the hours that were spent each day, and on the right, you see the hours that were spent each task. And when you sum those up each end, they should all add up to be the same thing. So it's just a quick check to see that what you're doing, that the hours you're reporting that and everything that sums up makes sense. I'm not going to pull this up here in the video, but I've posted an Excel sheet that has I might pull it up very briefly, but I've posted an Excel sheet, and this Excel sheet is a little more comprehensive. I'm not going to go into this in very significant detail, but I want to give you kind of a general idea on, you know, where these where data like this plays in the larger picture. This is a billability example for just essentially looking at a given project, but you can see we've got, you know, salaries, payroll taxes, indirect expenses, building costs, and what have you, and all of this feeds into the overall health of a project, which is going to feed into the overall health of a company. And if you don't have accurate records of that, it's going to create problems down the line. So I'm just going to let you all review this at your leisure, and we might talk about it next week a little bit. It's just something I wanted to bring up. Again, I think you all should review that on your own time. Now, also of importance to a company, a lot of this is really just to orient you to some terms that you might hear when you get out in practice. You know, when you hear somebody say, well, what's a balance sheet? This is so that you all have a general idea of what these terms are. So essentially, a balance sheet is a snapshot, if you will, of a company's given health. It provides a summary of a company's assets, which are its available resources, and its liabilities, how much that either currently or at a future state, how much that company owes. So it provides an illustration as to what a company owns and what it owes at any given point in time. Now the difference, when you look at a balance sheet, typically the figure should, and I say balance at the end of the sheet, the difference between a company's assets and liabilities is what's known as equity. So to give you kind of an idea, if somebody owns a car that's worth $15,000, but they owe $5,000 against a loan on that car, so they own the car, so that's an asset. Now let's say the car is $15,000, but they've taken a $5,000 loan out on that car, so the $5,000 would be a liability. The car would represent $10,000 worth of equity. So that's essentially what that is. To give you kind of an idea of what goes into a balance sheet, this is a pretty basic one just to give you an understanding of what goes into one. So this is looking at Paul's Guitar Shop, and again, a balance sheet is a snapshot. And you're going to see we have different financial documents, such as an income statement or a profit and loss statement, where it's not really a snapshot. It's more of over time. Okay. Now, to look at this. Okay. So if you look over here on the left, what you see over here on the left is a listing of this company's assets. So for instance, the company has about $32,000 or $32,800 in cash, either in its account or something like that. They have $300 that is coming into them, accounts receivable, prepaid rent of $1,000, and then their inventory, which rises just shy of $40,000. So they have current assets that total about $73,900. They also have some long-term assets for leasehold improvements and accumulated depreciation and stuff like that. So all in all, the company has assets totaling about $172,000. Now liabilities, what do they owe? Well, they owe $49,000 in payable accounts. They've accrued some expenses. They have unearned revenue that they haven't earned on some of their projects and what have you. So their total liabilities are about $150,000. So this is a company that would possess some positive equity, specifically equity of about $22,000, which is the difference between these two. It's just something to keep in mind. Okay, now also of importance is looking at an income statement. Now the difference between an income statement and a balance sheet is more of a snapshot of a company's financial health. A balance sheet will provide you an illustration of a company's health at any one point in time. An income statement, sometimes they're called income statements, sometimes they're called profit and loss statements or P&L statements. They represent a company's financial activities over a period of time. Oh, sorry about that. Over a period of time. When you look at an income statement, what you'll usually see is things like, okay, so if we're looking here, income statement for the year ended December 31st, 2015. So this is more of this is the a measure of the business that this company did throughout, let's say, a given year. Or usually income statements will be, sometimes they're for a year, usually maybe for a given month or something like that. For instance, looking at this company, you know, revenues, they sold about $27,800 in either merchandise sales or music lessons that they offered, but they also incurred expenses associated with that. They had to pay rent, they had to pay wages to their employees. If you sell, for instance, if you sell, like we're looking at a guitar shop, if you sell a guitar, well, let's say you buy the guitar for $100 and you sell it for $150, well, your expense is the $100 that you paid to purchase the guitar, and then the revenue is the $150 that you earned from selling it. So there's, you know, cost of goods sold, depreciation expense. If you have inventory that's sitting in your store for years and years and years, that's going to depreciate. Obviously, you know, a brand new piece of equipment, or in this case, a brand new guitar, is going to fetch more profit than maybe one that's a little bit older. There's, you know, again, on wages, rent, utilities, supplies, what have you. So ultimately, this company is doing okay. I mean, they're bringing in more income than they are spending. But again, this is sort of where an income statement and a balance sheet, where they sort of fill two different purposes. Again, the balance sheet is more like the snapshot. The income statement will give you an idea over time. Now, also that's of importance to a company is a company's insurance. And this is something that you're going to want to just at least be aware of when you get into the workforce. Companies carry insurance on their activities and on their equipment and on their employees. So it's definitely something you're going to want to be made aware of. For instance, you know, for engineering companies, they'll tend to carry general liability. They'll tend to carry professional liability. You know, professional liability. This is kind of like it's sort of akin to, if you've ever heard of a doctor carrying malpractice insurance. Well, engineers have to carry errors and omissions insurance. It's very similar. Usually they're carrying some degree of automobile insurance. So if you have a company truck or something like that, obviously only the employees should be driving those vehicles. Umbrella liability, just excess liability for anything that's above what's listed. Workers' comp, if you have a worker that's injured, companies need to carry that insurance. We've posted, there's an example insurance certificate posted on Blackboard. I'm just going to let you review that at your leisure, but just to give you kind of an idea of the coverage levels that companies have to carry. So let's talk about steps to obtain design work, specifically the process that is undertaken when a company, I guess the best way of putting it is the steps from, you know, when a job is created to when a company gets that job, and what steps go in between. So let's say, you know, a DOH or some large private agency, and by large private agency, you know, if we're talking about civil construction, it could be something like an insurance company that wants to build a brand new corporate headquarters. That's obviously not a small project. That's probably going to be millions of dollars. So in those instances, once the jobs are created and whatnot, usually the first thing that will occur from a consultant or a firm's standpoint, usually the first thing that they will do is express what's called an EOI, or an expression of interest. And this is sort of just to make sure that, okay, we are still interested in this project. Yes, keep me on your list of firms that you are considering. And this is partly just to sift out which firms are going to be interested in given work. I mean, this is a little bit of a stretch of an example, but if you're a paving contractor and there's a job put out to build a new bridge, well, that's probably a little bit outside of your area of expertise. However, if you're a paving contractor and the job is to pave, you know, 5 to 10 miles, or, you know, let's say 7 mile strip of a given interstate, well, yeah, I'm sure the paving contractor is going to be much more interested in that job. So the EOI request is just to make sure, okay, keep us in the loop, because we are interested. Next comes the RFP, the request for proposal. That's where you're actually where the owner is specifically listing what they want done. Sometimes, and it just depends on the project. Sometimes it's a detailed list. Sometimes it's give me a report with recommendations. Sometimes it's a task list and a cost estimate. It just depends on the given project. But once you have submitted your proposal, once the request for proposals comes out and the proposal is being reviewed, then hopefully comes the shortlisting process. So let's say you have a project and let's say 20 firms have submitted proposals, maybe only 5 of them or what have you, get shortlisted for a given interview. And we're talking about pretty large projects in this discussion. I mean, if it's a small project, you know, really small contract work, sometimes these are usually a straight award, like long-time client, you negotiate a fee and just go to work. This is more for really, really big projects. Now, shortlisting, there is some discussion there. You know, usually this is when the client is sifting through the proposals that have been submitted, and you know, the client obviously picks the ones that are thought to have a good proposal. But it's you know, one thing that should be emphasized is it's, you know, you probably heard the expression, you know, the low bid wins. It's not always the case that the low bid wins. For example, if you have going back to the example of the insurance company building a corporate headquarters, you know, let's say that you know, when completed, that job should cost about, let's say, $50 million. You might have, you know, really good proposals coming in at $51 million, $49 million, $48, but if you have one proposal that comes in at $6 million, just because it's the firm that has the lowest bid does not mean they're going to get the job or even be shortlisted. Because if you're bidding at that low of a level, then there's obviously something that you're not seeing for this given project. There's something that you're missing. So that, you know, in the shortlisting process, there is something to be said about the QAQC that's done to ensure that the bids that are being shortlisted are the ones, the proposals that are being shortlisted, are the ones that can actually do the work, because that's going to be a discussion a little bit later. Now, once you've gotten shortlisted, if you're talking about a really big project, usually there's some sort of formal interview, you know, where you're making a formal presentation on your project. You know, usually there'll be, you know, you'll send a few reps of your company to go make a formal presentation in front of a panel, and then from there the work is hopefully selected for your firm. Now, if you get the firm, we need to talk about some specifications and some drawings and what have you. So if you work on the design for, let's say, a given building or a given bridge, you know, your firm, let's say they will produce specifications and drawings for some, let's say, some contractor to build. One of the things that is sometimes not understood by engineering students, but it really needs to be understood by practicing engineers, is that specifications and drawings don't really tell contractors and things like that how to do the work. They simply tell them, you know, from point A to point B, here's what you need to produce and here are the specifications that need to be adhered. And the idea is, you know, if you tell a contractor how to do a particular job and then things don't go the way the contractor wants, contractor will say, well, that's how the engineer told me to do it. And then that gives the contractor room to submit what's called a change order. And we will talk about change orders later. So usually they cannot dictate exact items. Now, there are some instances where, you know, there's some sort of special condition where you kind of have to do that. But all in all, usually you are basically telling the contractor, here's what I need done. And in most cases, you figure it out. It gives the contractor freedom to build the structure as they see fit. let's see. So that's really what specifications drawings are. Bid documents. Bid documents are essentially, we're acting as the owner's representative. You're essentially creating a bid request that'll be advertised to the contractors and so on and so forth. I want to talk a little bit more, though, about looking at changed conditions. Changed conditions for a given project are you know, one of the things you'll find about civil engineering projects and just projects in general, when the money doesn't go, or when conditions change, or when money doesn't go the way that it was initially thought, or conditions on site are a little different than what you'd expected, and money starts changing, you know, the amount of money that you thought you were going to spend ends up being different than when you actually spent, and so on and so forth, that's where things get litigated upon. So if you ever hear the term changed conditions are, I mean, contractors love them. Engineers and owners don't like them very much, because if a contractor or something like that put a bid in to build, let's say, a given bridge, and they put the bid in for, I don't know, $2 million, and then during the project they find that things are different, it gives them a reason to charge more, because the actual conditions are different than what was listed on the big documents, and by that meaning either the drawings or specifications. Therefore, enter the change order. Change orders can be at all levels. Typically, they are from the contractor to the owner, and it's basically an additional charge above the contract for extra work. So, you know, if you're working on, let's say, a bridge, and the contractor finds that soil conditions are much different on site than were originally thought, that might necessitate the need for different foundations, which might change the might change the parameters of the project. So, you know, if change orders need to be issued, usually the general advice is to do it before the work is performed, or as soon as possible after the work is completed, because it reduces conflict at the end. You know, don't do the work and then come back and say, well, I need to be paid for you know, this work that we didn't originally agree I was going to do to begin with. That's just going to create more problems down the line. So hopefully, you know, if you ever encounter a situation like this, you know, handle it before the extra work is performed. Now, another term you might hear when you get out in the workforce is the term VE, or value engineering. Value engineering is when, you know, the owner or you know, the developer, let's say if you're looking at a building project or something like that, puts out a project, and then the contractor or the engineer comes in and says, well, I can actually give you the same project for a little cheaper, and here's why. So one of the big things that needs to be made aware of, who gets the savings. You know, the contractor and engineer can keep the savings, and the contractor and the engineer and the owner can split the savings based on a given contract. That's just something that needs to be made aware of at the very beginning. There are some instances where value engineering has some very serious advantages in the world of construction. You know, always bringing in a third party can make everybody aware of pitfalls and challenges that may not have been initially prevalent. So it's just something to be aware of down the line. A shop drawing review. So if a subcontractor or another engineer, you know, if you're if you've subbed out some work to a given firm, usually there is a process where you review some designs and drawings that have been submitted by them. And this is very common. For instance, if you're a structural engineering firm, you may sub out fabrication related details to a subcontractor. So what they will do is take the general parameters and descriptions of the project and actually produce the nitty-gritty details. I mean, every bolt, every weld, every connection and everything like that. So your job would be to check that against the specifications, the design recommendations, make sure it's constructible. I mean, if you're a structural engineering firm in charge of a whole project and you've gotten shop drawings back from the fabricator, you want to make sure it follows specifications, but make sure it also follows within the overall scope of the project. They're working in their small little bubble, and if you're the one in charge of the whole project, you need to make sure that what they have done conforms to what everybody else is doing. Now, one thing to be that's important, you do not actually stamp the shop drawings. The creator of the shop drawings stamps them. So if they are producing that initial design work, they should be stamped by the creator before you're getting them. So that's just something to be aware of from a liability standpoint. So a very common, for instance, in the world of building design is you might have a structural engineering firm that comes in and let's say it's designing a building. The structural engineering firm will design, generally lay out the structure and determine about where beams and columns need to be, and may even size those beams and columns to get a general scope of the project. Now, from there, sometimes the structural engineering firm will, let's say, will design connections and what have you. Sometimes they'll actually scope that out to a fabricator or something like that, and the fabricator designs the connections. So, in that world, if shop drawings are come in where they've actually spec'd out the connections, the fabricator would be responsible for those, and they would be the ones to stamp that. But, one other point to keep in mind is that these are things in terms that would hopefully be agreed upon before the relationship is even established. Everybody knows at the beginning who's responsible for what. A couple other terms that are kind of important. So an MOU, a memorandum of understanding, is generally an agreement between two companies or a client and a company that states that there's an intention to do some amount of work. There's typically no dollar value or consequences with it. It's just a way of kicking things off, just to make sure that you're aware of that. Terms and conditions, they essentially spell out, this is a little bit more further down the line when you're actually beginning to define and sign on the dotted line, if you will, for a given project. They limit liability on both parties, make sure everybody's aware, who's getting paid and who's getting paid what and when those payments are going to occur. The idea is to try and dispute settlements down the line. I'm not going to pull those up, but I have some example terms and conditions posted on the web. You should go through those as well. Now, a couple other things on project delivery. A lot of what I've been talking about in this lecture has basically been focused on a traditional model of project delivery called design, bid, build. The engineer designs the project, asks for bids, the contractor builds the project. It's a very traditional model for the delivery of engineering projects. And classically, this is how projects have been delivered. I don't really think that design, bid, build is going away anytime soon, but there are other modes of project delivery that are becoming a little more common. One of them is design build. So the engineer and the contractor work together on the design and construction. It's usually contractor dominated. It just depends on the process. This is becoming really popular in the world of bridges. An owner like a DOH or a county engineering department or something like that, they know that they want a bridge from point A to point B. They want it to be well maintained. They have a general idea of what material they want to use. Maybe they can find a contractor who not only can build the bridge, but has engineering staff that can design it. And instead of having to engage multiple different firms and organizations, you literally only have to engage one. That's becoming a really popular business model in the bridge world, and it's used in other locations as well. Another model that's becoming quite popular in bridges and in public work is a P3 model. If you ever hear the term P3, P3 stands for public-private partnership. And usually you have some public project that's financially backed by some private firm. And the firm could use any delivery method. The private firm will, once the project is initiated, they'll recover money from the public agency over time, or they charge users of the project. This is where like tolls or something like that come into play. But P3 projects tend to, this isn't always the case, but P3 projects tend to be used when you have massive projects, but really you have a lot of projects. For instance, if you're a state and you want to build hundreds of bridges, this is where a P3 project, something like that, comes into play. There's a P3 project in Pennsylvania not too long ago that was very similar to this, and in the right setting it works quite well. Last thing that I guess should be mentioned is teaming. More often than not, you are not going to be working alone on projects, and if you've got a really, really big project, sometimes it makes sense to team firms together to tackle on a larger project. And, you know, this is where firms come together with different skill sets, where they come together to complete a project. You know, if you're designing a, let's say, a building, you know, you can have one firm come in to do the architectural and engineering layout, one firm to come in and do the fabrication, a mechanical engineering firm to come in and do HVAC, and what have you. So you know, there's nothing wrong with that. There's nothing wrong with that in order to achieve a delivery, and it might even be the most economical solution in some instances. Typically, sometimes what can happen is a large firm can sort of combine with a smaller firm due to contract requirements. Could be a local firm, could be with contractor for design build or something like that. And some are very analytical, you know, not with big firms or only big firms. So it's just something to be aware of. And that's actually really all I have on the lecture. It's just sort of the purpose really of this lecture was just to orient you to just some terms and some ideas that you're going to experience when you get out in the real world. Just to recap, make sure that you're behaving professionally and always just sort of putting your best foot forward as soon as you get out of here. Again, I know that you might have wanted to get that job as the lead design engineer on a massive project, and then maybe your first job is doing material testing or something like that. You know, that's the best piece of advice. Just hang in there, and you will hopefully reap those benefits over time. And second part is just to orient you to just some of the documents and terms that you might be exposed to when you get out of here. And a lot of this stuff you will learn over time. But hopefully today's lecture gives you a little bit of a leg up as you move forward into that professional world. That's all I've got for everybody. I will see you all next week. And remember, we will be meeting in Drinko 402 to hear a presentation from Marshall University Career Services.